It's what you say. It's how you say it, what claims you're being made. And there are two. And by the way, for all pollsters, excuse me, we're pretty good at measuring the first, which is basically anti-establishment. It's a pox on all your houses. It's protest. It's dislike. It's the fake media. It's partisan judges. It's elected politicians who are corrupt. You've heard it all before. And that we're pretty good at measuring. What we're not so good at measuring is the second element, which is saying democracy, as in liberal democracy, is failing. What we need to have is the voice of the people, the real people, the people on the grassroots. And populism is the assumption that legitimacy is not based in Congress, it's not based in the White House even, it's based in the people themselves and their preferences and their priorities, and it's morally based in terms of where legitimate and moral authority should lie. And that we're not so good at measuring, although we have been having some new elements coming in. So if that's populist rhetoric, what's going on behind it? And what we argue is that it's when populist rhetoric is linked to authoritarian values that you get the risky, the dangerous, the destabilizing. The parties which come in saying, we're going to speak for you, trust me, I'm the one who can address your issues, address your concerns when the politicians haven't been. But when you have values which are authoritarian, that's when it becomes very risky for liberal democracy. And by authoritarian values, I do mean going right back to the classics of the 1950s and understanding how we can think about not the authoritarian personality, but the values behind that. And we argue that there are three. The first is a value of security. Excuse me. Thank you very much. My throat's giving way. It's the spring season, I do apologize. So one is the importance of security. There are risks out there, it's a dangerous world. There's a caravan coming at the wall. There are people who are going to attack us, and therefore we need to have a group solidarity. Conventionalism, tradition, the idea that we are being attacked, whether it's by groups who are foreigners, xenophobia, or by others who are seeking to destabilize, whether it's in terms of feminism, whether it's in terms of gay rights, whether it's in terms of misogyny. There are many different groups, and of course the rise of anti-Semitism. In 2019, a remarkable phenomenon when you think about it in some of the most affluent countries. And then if you can't trust the world, if there are enemies attacking us, if there's a security risk, then we need leaders, because there are very few channels where the people can actually speak, and the leaders are the ones who are going to protect the group. So that, for me, is essentially what Trump stands for, but also what many of these other parties stand for as well. An explicit value, and by the way, the idea that there's a threat, that there are insecurities, is not simply a myth. For us, it's real, because there are threats to people's values, whether it's about God and the rise of secularization, whether it's about the idea of marriage, and we have new forms of families and new forms of marriage, whether it's the idea of women and men and traditional roles, how those are radically changing, or whether it's about the diversity in society. All of those are major transformations in society which are threatening certain groups who find this very appealing. So the two things together are the danger. Authoritarian values hidden behind a populist rhetoric. And let's emphasize, not all populists are authoritarians. You get movements like Podemos in Spain, which are fairly liberal in their values, but equally populist. But the majority of the parties we're thinking about is authoritarianism, which is the danger, not populism. Now, what explains it? And briefly, there are three factors. I won't go into them all, but just to kind of sketch it out for a comprehensive explanation. On the one hand, there are the institutions. If we didn't have an electoral college in America, Donald Trump wouldn't be president, if we simply use the popular vote to give a simple example. If we didn't have low thresholds in an election, then we wouldn't have these parties as well. So that's an important factor that might explain the differences between countries. And then we have the values of the voters. Where are these appeals finding fertile ground? Who do they appeal to? Which groups? Which parts of society? And then we also have the politicians, the party competition, what the leaders are saying, and how they step into a vacuum. And you need all three parts going together to have a real breakthrough, and to have these parties and these leaders really managing to make a big impact, as we've seen. So explaining it We've always had these two rival explanations. And again, we don't need to make it up on the spot. We can go right back to the 1950s and Seymour Martin Lipset and those like Daniel Bell and think about those arguments. And these were all based on economic insecurity. And at the time, when they were trying to explain, for example, Poujadism in France, or they were trying to explain fascism in Weimar Germany, they went back to ideas of economic insecurity, in that case, about the squeezed petty bourgeoisie, the group in the middle, the small shopkeepers who were losing out to big business and they were losing out to organized labor. Today, of course, the argument is more that it's about an underclass who've lost out from globalization, particularly economic markets. Those who've lost out in the manufacturing base in large parts of middle America. Those who've lost their jobs and their communities and their factories and their schools. Now, if that's true, then we should find that those who subscribe to these parties and these values are clearly those who are least well off. And that's in terms of social class. That's also in terms of employment, also in terms of, for example, education and subjective feelings of economic insecurity. You've heard that argument many, many times. It's very common. For me, it's a little bit like a zombie argument. It keeps on popping up, even though we keep on trying to put stakes in it with the evidence. But it's often something which is seen as quite pervasive. Against that, what we have is the cultural argument. And the cultural argument is often seen as, well, you know, there's a cultural threat. But we have to understand why there's a cultural threat. And again, going back to my colleague Ron Engelhardt's work, it's about the changing values which have been going on for decades now. The 1960s and the 1970s, the rise of more progressive values. They were termed post-modernization or post-materialism. Nowadays, what we can see is that there's a wide variety of what you might term progressive or liberal values, which have really been expanding. And all of you know very well, if you look at the polls on things like tolerance of homosexuality, the way in which things have changed. For example, Obama couldn't even talk about gay marriage as a policy issue 10, 15 years ago. Now every state is moving it, even traditional societies. For example, Taiwan has just liberalized on gay rights. Whether it's support for open-mindedness towards other groups as well, such as women, and also support amongst the younger generation for international cooperation, globalization, and those forms of change. So what it's done, we think, this is the core argument, is it reached a tipping point. Now, the tipping point argument is something which is when the majority that used to be there, that enjoyed status and power and essentially hegemonic values, when they've moved and they've become increasingly a minority of the population, as the younger generation has expanded and the older generation has gradually died out, those values have changed in society. Think, for example, about the values of secularization in so many countries and the way that's gradually gone forward, and those who are of traditional religious faith in affluent countries has declined. If that's the case, that group who used to be the old majority have become the minority, and they really do face threats. But they also are often the group that votes, that turns out at elections, whereas the younger generation who have the more liberal values stay home. So there's an imbalance in our society as the tipping point happens, where there's anger on both sides. There's anger amongst those who feel that in America it no longer reflects God, guns, and gays, and marriage. And there's an anger amongst the progressives who thought they were winning and who suddenly find, as we see on issues like abortion, that in fact, if they don't get organized, if they don't vote, they're going to lose out on many of the things they thought had been there for 40 years. So if this is true, populist values should be predicted by things like education, clearly, but also by generation. Generation is the key cleavage, and it's the new cleavage it's always been there in many ways, but it's the new cleavage predicting support for Trump, and it's the new cleavage certainly supporting, for example, Brexit. It's the older generation who are supporting the Brexit Party. The younger generation want to be part of Europe. That's where they see their future, and that cleavage is fundamental. And as well as other things like race, ethnicity, and issues of urbanization. All of those are part of this broader cultural change. This is our big model. I won't go into it because it's far too long, but you can kind of get the idea. Certain things happen in society. It's a sociological theory, which in turn leads to the silent revolution. You've heard about that for decades now. What's changing is the tipping point of the cultural backlash, where groups that were the majority feel that they're no longer represented in Hollywood values, in the media, in Congress, where many progressives are still there. And that tipping point is the one that creates the authoritarian reflex. It is heightened, of course, by conditions, immigration and diversity under Angela Merkel of 2015, economic crises and recession also will increase this, but those aren't the causes, they're the catalysts for the more recent developments. And in turn, whether the parties get in, whether they get votes, depends on institutional conditions and party competition, and then the impacts. Now, let's move on. And how are we doing for time? God, 15 already. Okay. Parties. What does this mean for parties? What it essentially means in a nutshell is that we're always still in our minds thinking of the left-right, of the liberal versus the conservative, of those who favor state intervention in the economy versus those who favor markets. That's no longer the name of the game. Class has declined as a predictor of voting behavior. Economics has declined. And instead, what we have is the cultural cleavage that cuts across the old cleavage. So this is how we see party competition. In Britain, for example, again, to take the example, we have those who are populist, and it's not simply a particular party. I'd argue, for example, that in Britain, Jeremy Corbyn is fairly populist. I'd argue that Theresa May is fairly populist. By the way, not popular, but populist in the assumptions that she's making. Against that, we have the traditional parties who believe in liberal democracy, checks and balances, a variety of different forms of power. And the authoritarian versus libertarian cuts across that as well. So how does this work? Well, just to show you how our parties work, we can operationalize this and measure this. What we can do is we can use some data to look at CHES, which is a classification of parties based on expert estimates. And they have a number of different items which are very useful in Europe. And we can see where experts place the parties, for example, on these issues of freedoms and rights versus authoritarianism, on nationalism versus Europe, on civil liberties, on immigration, etc. And those are all the authoritarian values which are at the heart of these parties. We also have populist rhetoric, and again, not brilliant measures, but we have a couple. There are things like whether or not the party is anti-corruption, whether or not it's anti-establishment. And then we also have the traditional left-right, where they place themselves on the economy. I know this is far, far too small for anybody, even if you put on your glasses, and even if you're like 12 years old. But the point is that what this does is uses the data to classify our parties systematically across Europe. And so what you have is the cleavage between those who are pluralist on the left, those who are populist on the right, and you have the vertical cleavage between those who are authoritarian and those who are libertarian. So what we're talking about is the parties which are in the top right corner. And there you can see many different parties, for example, in Hungary, Jobbik, in Attica, in Bulgaria. But you can also see parties like the Freedom Party, like the Dutch parties, like the Swedish Democrats, and many others as well. Now, these are continuums, and so parties can switch, they can move back and forth, but broadly speaking, it's the parties in that corner that have found there's a large constituency of voters who are angry at cultural change and who will vote for them. Often this is about anti-immigration in Europe, but it's not only anti-immigration. It can also be against, for example, different changes in religion or different changes in society more generally. And against that, as we can see, we have all the other major parties. We have green parties down the bottom, very liberal. We have traditional conservative parties, and we have traditional Labour parties. So let's put the two things together. Is it the case that authoritarian and populist values predict these party supports? So what we can do here is we can turn to the European Social Survey, which is a brilliant survey done every 2 years in Europe. I used to call it the Rolls-Royce in terms of its methods, also in terms of its money, it's very expensive. But what they do is they do a survey, which is a panel survey of all the European countries, and they have some beautiful measures of authoritarianism, which is, of course, the Schwartz scale. And these are not about authoritarianism in politics. They don't ask about whether or not you favor a free press. They don't ask about whether or not you think elections are fair. They ask about your basic values, For example, for you, is it important you should always behave properly? A classic measure of authoritarianism. For you, is it important to live in security? For you, is it important you should have tradition or obedience? So that's our measure of authoritarian values. And do they predict these parties? Firstly, as you can see, what we have here is the personal authoritarian values, which are a scale going across the bottom, 100-point scale, and then you have the party, the location of the parties on the CHES data. So two different data sets, and there's a beautiful relationship between the two. And this shows you, again, in a very simple scattergram, which is about where the parties place themselves on these values, according to the experts, and where the public places themselves on these values, according to the European Social Survey. And again, it's a beautiful predictor. Turkey, under Erdogan, of course, very populist. Hungary, very populist. And we can see strong on both of those. And populist values, which are much more about protest, how far you feel that the system is responsive, how far you feel that you can trust it, are also a very good predictor of where the parties are in their anti-corruption stance. And this is the tipping point. What we did here was we looked at it by cohort of birth, and we looked across who held authoritarian and who held libertarian values. And you can see very nicely that it's a change which occurred around the baby boomers and onwards. So the older generation, the ones who were born before the war or in the interwar years, highly authoritarian, but the libertarian values rising amongst the younger generation and increasing their support until there's a tipping point. And the other point is that the tipping point also shifts from one place to another. So in a country like Sweden, the tipping point occurred fairly early. Everybody became more liberal. Young people became much more liberal very early on. But in a country like Ukraine, for example, where there's been much more difficult economic circumstances, a much more recent political change, the tipping point comes later amongst the generations. I won't go into this because it's too much stuff. You can't read any of it anyway. Let's just conclude by saying, okay, that's Europe. This is the American Association. Does it work in the United States? And the simple answer is absolutely. You can use beautiful data from Pew. You can use data from the National Election Survey. You can use the social survey data. And you find exactly the same pattern. It's a general pattern. So this is the moral conservatism scale. And this is from the World Value Survey. And the moral conservatism scale is another good way of measuring these basic values. And it's about the statements, for example, there should be more emphasis on traditional or modern family values, newer lifestyles of breaking down, et cetera, et cetera. And you can see whether or not somebody voted for Trump in 2016, whether or not they voted for Clinton, is beautifully predicted. Similarly, if we move on to how far post-materialism, and this is Ron's favorite chart in the whole of the slides, Clinton, post-materialist, Trump, materialist. The moral conservatism scale is a dramatic scale, and out of those who have strong moral conservatism, 95% voted for Trump. Amongst those which was weak, they voted for Clinton. And it's also very closely related to generation. As I've tweeted before, generation is the new class cleavage. Class is flat. Economics does not explain Trump, and this shows you that, the proportion by income who voted for Trump. And yes, it does go up and down. But as we know, some of the poorest groups were those voting for Hillary Clinton. Now, of course, that varies if you break it down by rural, urban, if you break it down by race. But nevertheless, economic status per se, socioeconomic status, doesn't predict clearly voting support for these parties or even voting support for major parties now in Europe. That has changed. So the conclusions, and here what I'll say is, firstly, education is clearly important, age is important, urbanization is important because that's part of the great sorting. Those who are left are the older populations, those who have moved to the urban areas are the younger populations, and cultural values above all else are what's behind this. And again, Those values, remember, are very powerful because we're not asking about direct things like, do you favor abortion? We're not asking about, do you favor gay rights? We're asking about basic values in your own life of obedience, tradition, and security. The change, we think, has to be explained by the tipping point, by long-term sociological changes in society, which have transformed Western societies, but the older population is still voting with the traditional values, so there's an imbalance in parliaments, there's an imbalance in politics. And the parties and the leaders have responded by mobilizing around these new cleavages. The last slide is what do we do? And here is a really complicated question. It's always being asked of me, and it's really difficult to know how to address it. On the one hand, you can say, well, we'll wait. If society is changing by generational changes, then in another 10, 15, 20, 30 years, the younger generation, just through demographic change, will expand in the electorate. The older generation will decline. On the other hand, what's going to happen in those decades? And is it that, therefore, liberal democracy is strong enough to withstand some of these sorts of changes? And as we've seen in Hungary, and as we've seen in some other countries which are really moving back, like Turkey, there are no clear senses that our institutions are strong enough if our democratic norms are crumbling. We can mobilize, we can have civil resistance. The marches have been tremendous, the ways in which people have come out on the streets. But again, as we've seen with Brexit, millions of people have been on the streets who still support Remain, but they haven't actually managed to change the politics so far. Electoral opposition, yes, but how many people in this room are going to say that Trump stands no chance in 2020? I think the number of bets would be quite small. Reduce economic inequality, well, that's a common way that many people have said should be used to bring in. Bring back social democracy, bring back social welfare, bring back a more egalitarian society, all of which I personally believe is absolutely right. Will it make a difference to these new cleavages? I'm not so sure. I'm not convinced. If the cause is not economic, then it's unlikely that the solution is going to be economic. And lastly, parties can respond. So they can take on these colorings. They can change their language. And mainstream parties can adopt some of the populist rhetoric and some of the policies. And it's quite interesting if you think about migration policy. In many countries, like in Germany, there has been a shift. Even under Angela Merkel, some of the most liberal ideas have been changing on migration in response to the new pressures. But are they going to be credible? Does that mean they're going to regain their support? That still remains a question which is not yet answered. And whether mainstream parties could or should change is again a big question. So the full consequences are still unfolding. We don't know where we're going to go. But we do think that, especially in polls, we need to have much better measures of populism, much better measures of authoritarianism. And I think that those are things which are really going to help predict what's going to happen in 2020 as we move and the new politics starts to play out. And the next elections to look at are clearly in Europe, the European elections. All of these parties are going to make tremendous progress. But so are other parties. So are the Greens in reaction. So are minor parties that are resisting these trends. So we'll have to see how things change as we move forward. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Pippa. That was fascinating. Wonderful presentation. We appreciate it. So Laura Silver is next. Laura, as I mentioned, is a senior researcher at the Pew Research Center, which does marvelous cross-national surveys. And she's going to present, I think, data from Europe on the subject of populism we're hearing about. Here we go, Laura. Thank you.
Thanks so much, everyone. As Pippa mentioned, there are a lot of challenges to actually measuring populism. And I figured, when will I ever have an audience at 7:30 in the morning again who wants to learn about measurement issues? So that's what I'm going to focus my work on today, is the challenges that we've had over time at Pew and the ways that we've chosen to measure populism to help explain some of the attitudes that we see in Western Europe. Before I get started, just a little bit of background about who we are. Pew was established in 1996 and is primarily funded by the Pew Charitable Trusts. We're a nonprofit, nonpartisan fact tank based in DC. And I work on the global team, and as part of these efforts, we've surveyed in 108 countries since 2001. Most of the work we've done on populism has been in the context of Europe, and that's what I'm going to focus on today. We've been heavily informed by the scholarship of people like Pippa Norris and also Cass Mood at the University of Georgia. So when we think about populism, we really think about the kind of fundamentals of the people being in opposition to the elite, the people representing the fundamental good and the elite being the fundamental bad, and the idea that when there is this tension, more efforts should be paid to acknowledge the will of the people. A lot of our work has centered on questions where understanding who is a populist is key. For example, we've measured whether or not people think that direct democracy or rule by a strong leader is a good or a bad way of governing the country. We might want to understand whether or not people who hold anti-establishment attitudes or populist attitudes feel differently about this. For example, when we think about Brexit, we really think that perhaps populists are more supportive of direct democracy. Or when we worry about things like Pippa was just talking about, we think that maybe rule by the military or rule by a strong leader might appeal more to populists than to others. In the era of fake news, when I'm reading about Nigel Farage's rallies also having chants against the media, we might want to understand whether populists are more likely to distrust the news media than those who don't hold those beliefs. Or when it comes to the EU, are we going to see other things like Brexit if we have populist supporters in these European countries? We want to understand whether populism is related to unfavorable views of the European Union. When it comes to whether or not people say that the EU promotes peace or democratic values, again, we may be interested in understanding these key dimensions. But how can we measure populism? One thing that we can do is we can classify parties as populists and look at people who support those parties or who don't. There are a couple of fundamental challenges here. One, as Pippa said, populist parties come in multiple different stripes and colors. Podemos, for example, has liberal values. How can we understand which parties are populist and which aren't? Is it what's necessary and what's sufficient? Rather than answering these questions across all of the countries that we study on an annual basis ourselves, we've relied on the experts, the same experts that Pippa mentioned in her presentation, the CHESS survey that comes out of Chapel Hill. Around 230 regional experts are asked to classify parties based on their party manifestos. The data we draw on for most of these countries is from 2017. And essentially, experts are asked to rate whether or not the elites and the public are in fundamental tension in these party platforms and the degree to which that's salient for that given party. We use that to form this anti-elitism score you see in the right column. We choose any party who scores over a 7.5, which is quite high on this scale, and label them to be populist parties. And we can simultaneously use the left-right ideology score that Pippa also mentioned to figure out whether or not these parties are a radical left or radical right. And indeed, most of these parties do fall into one of those two families as classified by the scholars, though I will point your attention towards Five Star and towards the League, now called League, in Italy, which do buck the mold a little bit and offer some of the, elucidate some of the reasons why it is difficult in many ways to classify populist parties. They really do vary. But it should be simple then, right? We figured out which parties are populist, so we can look at the people who identify with these parties and those who don't, and we've kind of set up our binary and we can go ahead and analyze. Unfortunately, it's not that simple. In our nationally representative surveys of about 1,000 people in each of these countries, if you simply ask people their partisanship, the party that they feel closest to, we don't tend to have enough people to thoroughly analyze. In the United Kingdom, for example, only 38 people support UKIP in our most recent data. It doesn't mean UKIP doesn't have an outsized role in European politics, though. And indeed, some of these parties also, we don't see in our party identification anyone who would support the Brexit Party because we polled before the party even came to light. So what have we done to combat this? We often can look at the favorable views people hold of these same parties as defined by CHESS, and we can see really important and interesting cleavages in terms of people's attitudes. Here, what you're looking at is the percentage of people who have a favorable view of populist parties compared to those who have an unfavorable view of these parties, answering the question of whether a democratic system where citizens, not elected officials, vote directly on major national issues to decide what becomes law would be a good way of governing our country. A lengthy way of saying, do we support direct democracy or referenda? And you see these blue dots are the people who have favorable views of the populist parties, and these are populist parties on the left and on the right. People who tend to have favorable views of these parties are much more likely to say direct democracy is good than people who have unfavorable views of these parties. We similarly see important and interesting cleavages when we ask things, for example, about whether the EU promotes democratic values. In Sweden, those who have a favorable view of the Sweden Democrats, about half of them say the EU promotes democratic values, while more than three quarters of people who have an unfavorable view of this populist party say the same. We also see, and as Pippa raised, these differences in terms of people's cultural values. When it comes to nationalistic attitudes, like it's important to have been born here to be truly one of us, or it's important to have our country's family background to be truly one of us, you see that people who favor the populist parties tend to be more likely to hold these positions than those who have unfavorable views. And the same is true when it comes to more nativist attitudes. I agree that our people are not perfect, but our culture is superior to others. Islam is fundamentally incompatible with our culture and values. But why might we want to move away from party batteries? We use this to great effect, but there are a handful of reasons that we think that this could be a little bit difficult in terms of some of our research questions. One is, as all of you are probably quite sensitive to, asking about all relevant parties in a country can create an incredibly long and tedious battery for respondents. We already are asking 4 to 5 parties at minimum in most of these countries, and to really understand the party landscape in some places, you actually probably need more than that. The second is that parties come and go, and we poll about once a year in most of these European countries. In Spain in 2018, we didn't have Vox as a country, as a party for favorability in our battery. That wouldn't have allowed us then to understand the true context of Spanish populism. The same is true of the Brexit Party, for example, as the upcoming European elections show. The third and perhaps more fundamental dimension is the idea that populism is the contrast between the elites and the public. You can imagine many people may not like any of these parties, even if they then turn up to vote and are disruptive in European politics. It's completely possible that you hold kind of anti-establishment attitudes, but don't like any of the parties that currently represent you, and we want to be able to capture those people as well. So, for this reason, we also wanted to figure out a way to measure the underlying populist attitudes that people have, and with that, we can then look at whether or not they support or don't support parties, which we're also unable to do if we define populism based on party support, because it's tautological. So to get at this, we created a measure of populism, and we created a measure of the left and right to really look at different groups within society. And the following slides that I'm going to show you get at a deep dive that we did in Western Europe at the end of 2017 to really understand what's happening in 8 European countries. Are we seeing kind of the destruction of the left-right ideology as the major force structuring people's attitudes? Or are we seeing that still playing a major role, but also the addition of kind of this dimension of populism? So what I'm going to show you are going to be these 6 groups, and I'm going to walk you first through how we defined populists. We did it on the basis of 2 questions. This is the first. Ordinary people would either do a better job or no better of a job than elected officials at solving the country's problems. People who said that ordinary officials would do no better, oh sorry, that ordinary people would do better than elected officials at solving the country's problems, and then people who also said that most elected officials don't care what people like me think are classified as populists. So you had to take both of those positions, that ordinary people would do a better job and elites don't care. This is kind of reflective of the general idea that I mentioned at the beginning, that we subscribe to the idea that populism is a thin ideology, but represented by this conflict between elites and the public, where the public should be more represented. And before I get into showing you the evidence, I need to walk you through what we internally called the sandwich graphics, because they can be a little bit difficult to read. What you're looking at here is an example from Italy, and it's the percentage of people who say adults think, it's the percentage of people who see EU membership has been good for their country's economy. What you're looking at vertically is the difference between people who hold populist views and people who hold mainstream views, not populist in our parlance. So 45% of people who are on the ideological right and don't hold populist views say EU membership has been good for their country's economy, compared to 25% of people on the ideological right who hold populist views. So vertical dimension is where we really see populist and mainstream differences. And then across the diagonal, for example, between the 67% and the 45%, that's where you really see that the traditional left-right dimension in European politics are still governing things. I'm going to show you first a slide about trust. In general, at the top line level, obviously you see that there are major differences between Northern and Southern Europe. But interestingly, across nearly all of the countries that we studied, there's almost no ideological difference, and the pattern's similar for all of these eight countries. What we really see is that populists differ greatly from the mainstream in terms of their trust in parliament, but regardless of whether or not you're on the left or the right, you tend to have relatively similar levels of trust in this institution in your given country. That's notably different than the United States, where Pew's work and the work of others has largely suggested that people's attitudes towards key institutions can be heavily structured by their ideology and by their partisanship, and can change when the party in power changes. That's not what we see here. For example, around 6 in 10 Germans in the mainstream, whether or not they're on the left or the right, tend to trust parliament. This isn't confined just to parliament either. We asked about trust in the military, trust in the media, and trust in banks and institutions, and the pattern's the same. What about the question of the economy? Again, at the top line level, we see major differences across Europe, largely a northern southern split. But when it comes to the actual patterns underlying it across these six groups, again, we see relatively consistent patterns across all of the countries. Again, very little difference based on whether or not people hold left or right-leaning ideological attitudes, and major differences between whether or not they hold populist attitudes or not. Again, in the United States, views of the economy can often be quite partisan and colored by ideology. Again, we're not seeing that in Europe. What we're seeing is the difference between the populists and the mainstream. When it comes to EU membership, once again, we really see populists kind of disrupting things and having different attitudes than the mainstream. Once again, it's largely a vertical dimension story. For example, in Denmark, almost everyone in the mainstream tends to have similar attitudes towards the EU having been good for their country's economy. Though here there is slightly more distinction, and particularly I would draw your attention to the bottom right corner for the UK. When it comes to the UK, we obviously do see some sizable differences between the ideological left and the ideological right, even while populists diverge even further. But I want to conclude by looking at immigration, because I think this is an idea that has really roiled the media and has attracted a lot of attention, that populists are fundamentally different when it comes to how they view immigration and the cultural threat. And indeed, while we're going to see some of that, I want to highlight how much of this still does appear to be driven by the left and the right ideologically. And we asked two other questions about immigration that I won't show you here for time purposes, but we really do see that immigration, while distinct particularly for right populists, is still colored heavily by whether or not people fall on the left or the right. So here's that data. You can see, for example, in the context of Denmark, the people on the ideological left who fall into the mainstream or the populist ideology camps, they're indistinguishable. And the same is true on the right. But in some other countries, we see greater divisions between the left and the right even. Where we really see people standing out, though, is the right populace. And if you look at Germany, Sweden, and Italy, three countries that have had major elections where populists have kind of disrupted the political landscape in notable ways, even if they haven't necessarily been fully victorious, we do see that right populists stand apart and tend to be the most likely to say that immigrants increase the risk of terror attacks in their country, often by a sizable margin. The rest of this investigation, and this report is available online, looked at kind of economic and social attitudes as well as party support. And while we see very little impact of populism on those key dimensions, when it does come to these more fundamental concerns of trust in institutions, particularly the EU, confidence in the economy, and especially immigration, we do see that populism is changing the landscape in key and important ways. Thank you.
Fantastic, Laura. Thank you very much. Our next speaker is one of my favorite. And the beautiful thing about being both moderator and speaker is there's no one on my left to put those little annoying pieces of paper in my face saying, wrap it up. And away we go. Rise of populism, in this case, from a polling perspective. In thinking about how to approach this presentation, I started with the obvious first step. I read the newspaper. This is a clip from a recent New York Times, just as it appeared in the Times. In the top, we see that a speech to young European leaders, former President Barack Obama warned of the dangers of far-right populism, and then the two items below, we see that a revered populist has died. So it's bad, so it's good. Whatever it is, I then see in my new issue of The Economist, it's upon us, central banks in the age of populism. So it's here. The question I think we've all been grappling with is, so what is it? Populism is defined, I think, as a political program or movement that champions the common person, usually by favorable contrast with an elite. It has no fixed partisan or ideological agenda. It's equally hostile toward business and labor. It seeks disintermediation between leaders and the public. A great example is the U.S. populist movement at the turn of the century, which gave rise to state legislation authorizing ballot initiatives across the country. It's often associated with authoritarianism, but not necessarily, as we've seen. Jan Werner Muller, author of What is Populism, a recent book, and quite a good one, adds, it's not anti-liberal, but anti-pluralist. Populism co-opts democratic rhetoric to delegitimize democratic institutions, and it claims sole representation of the people, an imperative mandate. Pippa Norris focuses, as we just heard, on authoritarian populism, leading her to not one but two definitions. Populists, who adopt a rhetorical language and governing style that challenges the authority of the elite, with legitimacy flowing directly from the voice of the people. And authoritarianism, in which policy positions are adopted which endorse xenophobic nationalist values. I do recommend Pippa's book, it's terrific. Not all populists, as she points out, are authoritarian, and not all authoritarians are populist. Other attributes, I think, in populism include the establishment of a cult of personality by the leader, a demonization of the media, discreditation of the judiciary, and efforts to override or bypass the legislature in effort to get that throughput, so-called, from the people to the leader. This all sounds pretty right-wing. And is that the case? I think we can wonder about it. On the one hand, in this chart, we see successful political parties and individuals, all of which, I think, or at least most of which, can fairly be described as right-wing. At the same time, as we've heard to some extent, there are many populist figures and parties that are not fairly described, I believe, as authoritarian as right-wing. Indeed, interestingly, the last two national leaders who I believe could perhaps be described as populist to be elected to take power are perhaps progressive populists. Zuzana Kapitova, new president of Slovakia, an outsider anti-corruption activist. We don't know so much about Volodymyr Zelensky, but a complete outsider elected in the Ukraine. And most recently, Lori Lightfoot, the new mayor of Chicago, the classic machine politics city, but here's a complete outsider elected. In its coverage of her election, the New York Times said, Ms. Lightfoot's win signaled a notable shift in the mood of voters and a rejection of an entrenched political culture. And that phrase stuck with me, this rejection of an entrenched political culture that the Times spoke about there. It reminded me of what we've seen in our national elections since 1992, this bounce back and forth between the parties. Consider 1992, Bill Clinton is elected. 2 years later, he loses, his party loses 54 seats. Then he's reelected. 2000, Bush is elected. The pushback, his party loses 30 seats. Then he's reelected. They're playing ping pong back and forth between the parties. 2008, Obama's elected. 2 years later, he loses 63 seats. Then he's reelected. Then Trump is elected. Then his party loses 40 seats. Now you can say, sure, but we always see presidents lose seats in their first midterms, and that's the case. But the average first midterm losses since 1946 has been 25 seats, whereas the average losses since 1994 has been 47 seats, nearly twice as many. It makes me wonder if the populism we're seeing is another term for rejection of the status quo. And if so, What about the status quo are we rejecting? Is it economic? Is it cultural? Economic frustration, discontent, we could describe as frustration with the absence of opportunity or a safety net, growing income and wealth gaps, systemic and technological threats to living wage employment. Culturally, we could talk about pushback against multiculturalism, as Pippa pointed out, and liberalism, in-group retrenchment, submission to perceived legitimate authority, expressed in xenophobia, nationalism, ethnocentrism, and anti-elitism. In 2016, we modeled support for Donald Trump, first in the primaries. We found in our data, this is ABC News Washington Post poll that we reported in a piece we called Trumpismo, that there were two inputs, economic discontent, predicted populism as we defined it, which predicted support for Trump, and preference for authority, predicted, or authoritarianism, if you will, predicted pushback against other groups, which in turn predicted support for Trump. We operationalized these as follows. Economic discontent didn't just mean your income or your class level, but whether you described yourself as struggling to maintain your class level. Authoritarianism, we adapted the classic scale. Is it more important for a child to be independent or to have respect for others, et cetera? Populism, we defined in this piece as preference for an outsider, a view that the government is dysfunctional and anger at the way the government was working. And pushback was based on views of deportation, Muslim ban, and whites losing out. I showed you the regressions that we produced in the primaries. In the general election, it was very similar. Economic discontent, predicted populism, going through views of life under Obama, predicted support for Trump against Clinton. Preference for authority, predicted this pushback I've described. Now, there are many social, political, and cultural reasons for public dislocation. The internet and the echo chamber, it gives us the threat of terrorism, climate change, changing social mores, the immigration, school violence, and all the rest. Unsettling elements in today's society. Yet another is the change in the basic demographic makeup of our country. This is census projections, which show our country well on the path to becoming a majority-minority country. That said, if the phenomenon of populism is global, I do ask, what about globalization? And yes, I'm about to make Pippa's zombie argument about the role of the economy in populism. I think maybe you can't kill it because the data support it. But I also think that we're really talking about multiple inputs, if you will, and that social and cultural impacts and economic as well are at play. When the rate of return on capital exceeds the rate of growth on output and income, as it seems quite likely to do in the 21st century, capitalism automatically generates arbitrary and unsustainable inequalities that radically undermine the meritocratic values on which democratic societies are based. That's the almost unreadable Piketty in Capital in the 21st century, but he makes a key and really important point. The promise of government, as I see it, as I've studied it over the last 30 plus years in our public opinion research, is that people really look for three things from their government, not a lot more. And those are security, liberty, and the opportunity for prosperity. Not the promise of prosperity, but the fair chance at achieving it. When these are not delivered, any of these, people get upset, they reject the status quo, they look for alternatives in leadership, and divisions on policy and in values gain salience because we're in a snit. This includes in-group retrenchment, suspicion of others, the acceptability of radical alternatives, bitterness and mutual incomprehension, and hyper-motivated reasoning. We can see it just, for example, in the correlation of political party identification and ideology in our country, which has increased dramatically since 1988 in these data, ABC News, Washington Post data, from less than 0.4 to nearly 0.6 correlation. Another way to look at those data are to see that the proportion of Republicans who define themselves as conservatives has gone from 45 to 65%, the proportion of Democrats who describe themselves as liberals from 33%. To 45% is an ingathering or retreating to our ideological corners within the political parties. The economy is the next piece that I want to talk about in some detail. It's an incredibly powerful force, and when it goes off the rails, it makes an awful mess. You may say, what's the problem? Unemployment rate is 3.6%. We're in fantastic shape. That's kind of so, except the fact that the unemployment rate is kind of a BS statistic, because it doesn't count people who've given up looking for work. It doesn't count people who've taken a part-time job when they want a full-time. It doesn't count philosophy majors with $100,000 in debt working as baristas at Starbucks. The U6 rate, more than double the U3 unemployment rate, is 7.5%, and not so good historically. Long-term unemployment, while down from its heart attack levels of 2011 and 12, is still higher than typical in data set going back to 1948. And I think, to me, most impactful is this slide. This is over the past 40 years, so it's not just a result of or since the Great Recession. If you have a bachelor's degree or more, then your real income over this long period, more than a generation, your real income has increased by 27%. You're doing okay. That's against inflation. If you don't have a four-year college degree, your real income against inflation has declined by 8%. You're not doing as well as you were in the past. The obvious next question is, what proportion of the U.S. public, let's say age 25 and older, does not have a four-year college degree? And the answer is 65%. So the reason that the vast majority of Americans feel as if they're doing less well is because it's true. Where do you go for a decent living if you don't have a four-year college degree? Well, manufacturing used to be a great choice. Manufacturing employment has plummeted in our country from nearly 40% to less than 10%. What's plan B if you don't have a four-year college degree? Well, retail, except that retail pays 20% less than manufacturing, and it's not doing great. Thank you, Jeff Bezos. You may look to join the 5 million Americans who drive for a living. How's that looking? So there are serious economic challenges facing the country, facing individuals in it. Aggregate household income by quintile. 60% of Americans earn 27% of the nation's income. The top 5% of earners earn 23% of the nation's income. Look at the distribution of family wealth. That's income. This is wealth. Look at the difference between the 50th and 99th percentiles in 1963, 20 years later in 1983, quite similar, and today. We can just run out the ratios, 99th to 50th percentiles. We've gone from 36 to 1, 40 to 1, to 107 to 1. This is not just an American phenomenon, although it's most prevalent in the United States. The top 10% of wealth in our country, the top 10% of wealth holders own 80% of the country's wealth. The top 5% own nearly 70%. And these are dramatic proportions across these industrialized and developed countries. Consumer sentiment is up sharply, sure, in recent years, but the increase is occurred disproportionately among the better off. So we asked a new question in our latest ABC News Washington Post poll just a few weeks ago. I snuck this in for this presentation. Do you think, blank, this item in this country works mainly to benefit all people or works mainly to benefit those in power, the political system and the economic system? 72% of Americans think that the country's political system mainly benefits those in power, not all people. 62% of Americans think the country's economic system mainly benefits those in power, not all people. Consider the intensity of that sentiment as well. It's not a trivial or a lightly held view. Not only does 72% say the political system benefits those in power, 56% feel strongly that that's the case. And we have nearly half saying strongly that the economic system benefits those in power. How does this play out politically? Well, it looks to us like Donald Trump is in danger of becoming the next status quo victim, if you will. Among those who think the political system benefits all people, he gets overwhelming support, 62% support. Among the majority who thinks the political system benefits those in power, his support is far lower. This, by the way, support is those who say they definitely will or will consider voting for him for re-election. It's even more profound on views of the economic system. Among those who think it benefits all, 70% say they'll either support or consider Trump. as opposed to barely over 20% of those who say the economic system benefits those in power. We predict Trump approval, first using our standard, this is from our most recent ABC News Washington Post poll, using our standard demographic variables, we see that the typical predictors emerge, those in bold at the bottom, that is ideology, partisanship, and race and ethnicity. Then we add to the equation this sentiment about the political system, whether it benefits all people or benefits the powerful, and it emerges as a very significant and powerful predictor of approval of President Trump, 0.16. And as you can see there, we add 3 points to our R squared. Now let's pull out that view of the political system and put in views of the economic system. It emerges even more strongly, indeed, as the strongest predictor in our equation of Trump approval. And it beefs up the R squared from 0.48 to 0.55. Now, just as a check, we can put them both in, an index of the two, views on the political and economic system. Strong predictor, but it doesn't add anything. And in fact, we lose a point on our R squared. So it seems to us, again, that this sentiment about the economic system is significant in driving support for Trump. And indeed, it works as well on 2020 vote as it does on his approval rating. So in conclusion, populism, operates independently of traditional norms and ideologies, instead has its own ideology, us versus them, is inherently confrontational rather than collaborative and exclusive rather than inclusive, feeds on social and cultural rivalries, reflects a rejection of the status quo, and in our data, relies on economic discontent. Thank you very much. Returning to my moderator role, we've got a few minutes. Is there any questions that anyone wants to pop up with? Please do. Shoot.
So the question is that the goalposts move, absolutely. 2016 for the June referendum was the worst ever time to have a referendum. I mean, Cameron messed it up in so many ways, but the timing was one of them. Because of course, 2015 was when Angela Merkel opened the door, said welcome, everybody streamed in, and so that heightened the fears. And in the Eurobarometer now, immigration has gone down. So the question then is, how do the parties respond? And in many ways, this is the classic idea that there are moving goalposts in public opinion, and the parties are kind of chasing after them. They can't go too far to the left or the right, or they can't go too populist or too pluralist, because they miss out. But they're chasing after. And how do parliamentarians actually understand what public opinion is? This is the classic question. And they're often behind the curve because they're using measures and they think about how they succeeded last time, and that's how they're going to succeed this time. So it's a real challenge about what they do. I think in terms of the actual situation with Brexit going on right now, the Lib Dems are clear. They've never changed. They've always been the most pro-EU party, which there is. And that in some ways is a virtue, because now the public is saying, at least they have a very clear position. Labour has tried to straddle the fence, both between Remain and Leave, because they know that they've got different constituencies, and it's not credible. And that's exactly why they've been losing support. The latest poll, which you might have seen, is that the Brexit Party in YouGov is around 34% in the European elections, according to YouGov, whereas Labour and the Conservatives are around 15%, as I remember, which is way behind, and other parties are even further behind, including Change UK. So Brexit has taken a very clear stance. They're pro-Brexit and they're anti-EU. The Lib Dems have gained through saying we're Remain, and the ones who have tried to be in the middle, including the Conservatives, it's quite interesting in the YouGov poll when people asked what does the Conservative Party stand for when it comes to Brexit, people didn't know because, of course, there are different wings, and so they couldn't work out exactly what was going on. So parties need to change, to come back to that first question, but they also need to bring all their factions with them. And as soon as they try to change, for me, it's a bit like an ocean liner trying to shift course. You can't do it fast because you're going to have some people, some members, some parliamentarians who won't go along with those sorts of changes. But where they can move in adapting to public opinion, they then have to make sure the public opinion hasn't changed back. So it's an incredibly difficult balancing act for any parties. And small parties are much more nimble than large parties who have all the weight of their ideology, their manifesto, their baggage of what they've done last time. So you're quite right, it's one of the key challenges for how any major party tries to adapt to these new pressures. You can create a new party overnight, as Brexit was, and suddenly they've taken over. And it is just incredible if you've been following. Nigel Farage, after all, he left UKIP, remember, because they turned rather BNP-ish. And so he created the new party, and immediately he's up there. And it's not only in the European Union election. Again, YouGov asked in Westminster if you were going to vote today, how would you vote? And the Brexit Party apparently comes number one. Now, it's only in this particular time period that that's happening. It won't actually happen in the general election. But again, it shows you what you're doing is you're basically destabilizing party politics through these dramatic developments. Small parties can do that and not gain a penalty. Large parties, really problematic.
We're close to 9 a.m. If anyone has to leave for the next session, feel free. And if anyone wants to hang out, feel free. Is there a question elsewhere in the back? Yeah, please.
This is a question for Pippa. Can you talk a little bit about the strategies that the populist parties in Europe use when naming their parties?
Strategies they use in... I'm sorry, I didn't catch the last one.
So I find that many of the parties in Europe, they're very... The names of them, I'm often not sure which ones are good and which ones are bad because the names always sound so appealing.
Absolutely. So the anti-party, obviously, their supporters are anti-party. So you don't call yourself a party, you call yourself a movement, and then you call yourself something vague often, which is just not in the classic way. So all of the parties, I mean, the five-star movement, what does that stand for? It could be anything. It has no liberal baggage, it has no labor baggage, it has no socialist baggage, no conservative baggage, nothing. And so you get a wide variety of different nomenclatures. And of course, nobody calls themselves populist. Trump, I think, has never actually mentioned or tweeted the word. It's quite remarkable. I could be wrong, but I don't think he's ever gained ownership or even talked about populism per se. So what you do as a populist party is you pretend you're not a party. You're something else, and then that's how you gain support. Is my view. But Laura might have a view as well.
No, I think.
Anyone else?
Yes.
Please.
That's all right. Thanks very much, by the way. Really, really interesting discussion. I appreciate all three presentations. There's one thing that I think it was on Gary's slide. And I wonder whether the three of you can speak to what seems to me to be sometimes conflating wanting certain kinds of change that apply to the whole population, like a one-payer health system or free university education, with populism. It's always struck me as not really being an anti-elite position, but I saw it on Gary's slide there on the right, among populists. Examples. And I mean, does it necessarily relate that if you're pushing for something more, let's say, socialist, that that's populist? It seems like some of the campaigning stuff is just necessarily part of we're here to help you, which doesn't necessarily mean we're here to hurt others.
That's a really good question, and one that we are interested in digging into more, but some of the discrepancies you'll see in terms of the country performance on different indicators that we have are a little bit suggestive of the fact that who is the us can vary based on people's answers to these questions. So supporters of the Danish People's Party, for example, tend to be relatively progressive in terms of what they would like economically, but they're very exclusionary about who those benefits would go to. They tend to believe that they should go to the Danish people, who in most DPP supporters' views would be white and probably Christian, not to the immigrants or to all people living in Denmark. So I think the who the us is can matter quite a bit in terms of understanding support for populism and how it relates to these values.
No, I'd agree very much with Laura. Welfare nationalism is the idea that you belong to a system and therefore you get those benefits, but not for the outsiders. But the other point to make is that populism is also about making very vague promises and very large promises and kind of radically shaking things up. And so often populists come in with all sorts of outrageous promises which were never going to be implemented, but which they can often do, especially if you're a minor party who knows that you're not going to be in government. When they get into government, that's when you get the contradictions between what they're promised to do and what they can do. And that's where the real tensions often arise.
Thanks. Yeah, I agree. And I'm also told there's a bar mitzvah coming into the room, so we have to end our session. Thank you all very much for coming.
Do no wrong.